Welcome to the sixth part in our series on carbohydrates, a section covering diabetes. The definition of diabetes is a disorder in which blood sugar, which is blood glucose, levels are abnormally high. There are two types of diabetes, type 1 and type 2, and we're going to go over the characteristics of each type. Type 1 typically occurs in childhood, whereas type 2 typically occurs in adulthood. But these are only generalizations. For example, Jay Cutler, the quarterback for the Chicago Bears, developed type 1 diabetes while he was playing professional football. And we're increasingly seeing more children developing type 2 diabetes. The cause of type 1 diabetes is based on if an autoimmune disease. And what that means is the body ends up attacking its own organs. And in this instance, it's the beta cells of the pancreas. It recognizes it as foreign. For some reason, it thinks that it's a bacteria or an invader, and the body creates an immune reaction specifically for these cells, destroying the cells so they cannot secrete insulin. Now, in type 2, it's more multifactorial. There are many factors, obesity, especially abdominal obesity, insulin resistance, diet, and genetics. Genetics does play a role. Genetics do play a role, but just because you have diabetes that runs in your family doesn't mean you have to develop diabetes, because your lifestyle and diet and how much you weigh is going to be a much greater factor. In type 1, we look at the pancreas. There's an autoimmune disease. The beta cells of the pancreas are destroyed by the body. This usually happens in early childhood, and the pancreas cannot secrete insulin. With type 2, the cells, for example, the muscle cells, the liver, or other cells that need energy, they don't recognize insulin. And remember, insulin helps bring glucose into those cells. So usually too much is secreted initially, until the beta cells of the pancreas wear out and then they eventually don't have any insulin left to secrete. But that's in the later stages of type 2 diabetes. About 5 to 10% of the cases are type 1. So that means most of the cases of type 2 diabetes, 90 to 95% are type 2 diabetes. So most of the diabetes we see today is acquired diabetes, type 2. I want to go back and review blood glucose regulation quickly so I can explain how the differences between type 1 and type 2 diabetes. And I'm going to start with some carbohydrate-based food. And remember that when you eat the carbohydrate-based food, that starch is digested to glucose chains, to maltose, to glucose. So what happens? We get a high blood glucose, increased glucose in the bloodstream. The pancreas responds by releasing insulin. And insulin then assists the glucose into the cells. And I didn't have this in my previous lecture, but I do want to point out in this diagram that insulin also assists glucose back into the liver, also in the muscle, and then it will help store glucose as fat in the fat cells. So once insulin does that action, you can see the glucose goes into these storage areas, and what does that do? That lowers the blood glucose. So we get back to a normalized blood glucose. So that's normally how it's supposed to work. So let's look at type 1 diabetes. Again, we'll start with a carbohydrate-based food, and it's not as if we're all eating just carbohydrates or just protein or just fat, because there is some protein in the bagel that I have diagrammed here. But and I also want to point out that both fat and protein will also cause a release of insulin. It's just the most dramatic response of insulin in the body is from a really refined carbohydrate. So any sort of food that we're eating is going to have some response. But if we look at a carbohydrate-based food, remember the carbohydrate, it's broken down, it is ends up having the glucose absorbed into the bloodstream, and then the pancreas is supposed to release insulin. But what happens in type 1 diabetes? The insulin is not there. Remember, it's an autoimmune disease. Type 1 is an autoimmune disease. The body destroys the beta cells of the pancreas. So no insulin can be released. So what does that mean? Gradually, we don't have any insulin, and that means that no insulin is going to be assisting glucose into the liver, nor the muscle, and even a harder time storing fat. So type 1 diabetics are actually typically fairly lean. Okay, so what about type 2 diabetes? Well, type 2 diabetes is going to start with insulin resistance. This is the precursor to the disease. So let's go through this again. We start with our food, carbohydrate-based food that lends to glucose into the bloodstream. Now, what happens, now normally, remember, we get the insulin response, and insulin is going to drive the glucose into the muscle, into the liver, and then it'll help with fat storage. But in the instance of insulin resistance, or a pre-diabetes state, the cells are not recognizing insulin. So it's a very slow process for the glucose to get into the liver or to get into the muscle. The cells are essentially saying, there's too much insulin, I don't recognize it anymore. It's almost like the boy who cried wolf. We think about someone who's constantly, you know, screaming for help, but then it isn't a problem, the boy who cried wolf, right? So eventually you hear that scream from that certain individual and you don't believe them anymore, right? You just kind of ignore them. It's almost like the cells are doing the same thing. It's like the insulin has been around so much because the sugar is constantly so high and the insulin is around so much that the cells aren't recognizing it as much. So it's a very slow process to bring in the glucose into the cells. Now, what results is in the initial stages is that the blood sugar will actually go back to normal, but look how much insulin is there. So the initial stages is a normal blood glucose, but a high insulin level. Unfortunately, this leads to storing a lot more fat because insulin is our fat storage hormone. So most the cell is hard to bring it into the muscle and to the liver, but it's easy to bring it in and store it as fat. So this is, if you were to get a blood test and you had insulin resistance, you would initially have a normal blood glucose level through the lab because insulin is doing its job. So there's a lot of insulin and it's overcompensating because there is so much glucose in the bloodstream. Okay, so again, slowly bringing it into the muscle, but that does allow for more fat storage. So this is the earlier stages of diabetes, so almost a pre-diabetic state. Now, once type 2 diabetes happens, and again, we go from our carbohydrate-based food to increased blood glucose, insulin is released from the pancreas, and insulin normally transports this glucose into the muscle and then the liver, but at this point, not able to get into the muscle cells. So you're not getting that energy into the muscle. So if the insulin can't bring the glucose into the muscle, then the result is a high blood glucose, elevated blood glucose, but also elevated insulin as well. So we have high insulin, high blood glucose, and the muscle cells need energy. The quick form of energy in the muscle is with glucose. So that person who wants to do exercise is going to feel really fatigued, is not going to have that extra energy to move their muscles. In addition, insulin is our fat storage molecule. So even though fat cells can develop insulin resistance, they do so at a later time, usually the muscles are affected first, but because insulin wants to promote fat storage, the fat that's in the fat cells can't get out. So at this point, someone with diabetes has a high blood sugar, a high insulin level. They can't get energy into their muscle cells, the glucose, to use for energy, nor into the liver so they can release it into the bloodstream. And they have a hard time getting energy out of the fat, so the fat out of the fat stores. So what you're left with is feeling very low on energy. There's no desire really to exercise, and you have a lot of stores of energy in your fat cells, you just can't get them out. So with type 1 and type 2 diabetes, the cause is different, but the result is the same: high blood glucose. These are a series of images from slides from the CDC, and it talks about the diabetes prevalence between 2004 and 2011, and this is the most recent information they have. And I want to look back to 2004, so look at the very light areas and look how much light areas we have in here, light yellow, a little bit of orange. This is less than 6.5% of individuals in each county with diabetes, and you can see it's a little bit concentrated in more of the southern states here, especially on the East Coast. But in through these regions, you don't see as much diabetes, right? Then what about the red? Look at the areas of red. You can see a little bit of red in here. This is over 11% of these counties, and you can see them represented by county and then state, that have diabetes. So let's watch as the prevalence increases throughout the years. Now look at the increase in the red, and we're watching the yellow almost disappear. So what state here? We got Colorado that has the lowest prevalence of diabetes. We have some of the western states have less, but look in through the south and through here. This is greater than 10%. So it's a dramatic, dramatic change and just in the last decade or so. There are now 29 million Americans estimated with diabetes. And remember, most cases are type 2 diabetes. So when I'm giving you these stats, it's mostly for type 2 diabetes. Scary is 1 in 4. We don't know it yet. 86 million have pre-diabetes. So that's insulin resistance. So now we're getting, you know, the 86 and 29, you know, we're getting to 30% of our population with either diabetes or pre-diabetes. And this is a statement by the CDC. In 2012, diabetes and its related complications accounted for $245 billion, with a B, in total medical costs, lost work, and wages. So what are the complications? Why would you not want to get diabetes? Besides the fact that you'd have to take a pill every day and you'd have no energy and be overweight, potentially inject insulin, there are a lot of complications that are associated with diabetes. Eye problems, kidney problems, high blood pressure, numbness in the feet. This is something as a podiatrist that I see all the time. And in fact, what's really interesting is I see individuals in the pre-diabetes range that have developed numbness in the feet. They haven't even been diagnosed with diabetes yet, and they're already developing the complications associated with diabetes, showing how important it is to keep the blood sugars low, because that effect of blood sugars on your body, that's what it is. Blood sugars are contributing to these complications. That impact can cause those complications to develop even before diagnosis, which is really scary. Open sores is the result from the numbness. I see this all the time as well, which soon develop into infections and result in amputations. Stroke, heart disease. This is not a complete list either. So these are just some of the complications associated with diabetes. And lastly, I'm just going to bring up mental health issues. Depression and dementia are two mental health issues associated with diabetes. So what are the risk factors? And T2DM is just an abbreviation for type 2 diabetes. And I got this picture here, and because it really does show the abdominal obesity that's associated with diabetes. And this abdominal obesity generally develops as a result of diet and inactivity. You can have a genetic predisposition to type 2 diabetes, but that doesn't mean you'll get it. If you are exercising, you're staying lean, you are eating healthy diet, very active, then even if you have a genetic predisposition, you're not going to get diabetes. And if you have diabetes, you can manage it very well with diet and exercise. Then one last point is that the key and the precursor as well as the key are the characteristic of type 2 diabetes is insulin resistance. Okay, so if we look at how this cycle, you can get into this horrible cycle, we'll start with kind of this high sugar, high starch, refined carbohydrates, low fiber, you know, low in fruits and vegetable type diet. Physical inactivity, so being sedentary, and then genetics, so those are predisposed to it. This generally leads to obesity, so weight gain. Weight gain leads to more fat mass. When there's more fat mass, there's more, there's elevated blood lipids. Those also contribute to heart disease as well as insulin resistance. Low-grade inflammation, we'll talk about this later. So having more fat on your body, having more circulating levels of blood lipids and the diet contribute to insulin resistance. And then the development of type 2 diabetes, which is really a hormone imbalance. When there's too much insulin, there's too much sugar, there's insulin resistance. This means that there's an inability to use glucose for fuel. So remember, if you don't have the insulin to drive that glucose into the muscle, into the liver, then you end up not having any energy. And there's also increased fat stores because insulin won't, it's like a lock and a key. It won't let the fat out of the fat cells because it wants to store it. Remember, insulin is a storage, fat storage hormone. And that contributes to more obesity. And then we go through the cycle again. So how can we prevent that? Well, if you start with, you know, a low sugar, low starch, low refined carbohydrates, high fiber, whole foods diet, have physical activity, remain lean, you have a low fat mass, normal blood lipids, low inflammation, insulin sensitivity, meaning your cells are sensitive to insulin. That does not result in a hormonal balance. You can use that glucose for energy, and there are fewer fat stores. Now, we've seen this before, but I'm going to show you how the type of diet and lifestyle that will help prevent diabetes. So we already talked about this, whole vegetables, not processed, whole fruits, not fruit juice, so not processed, whole fruits, whole grains. I have minimal on here because you don't want, it's not that you can't eat whole grains, but whole grain bread is not a whole grain. Remember, that's a highly refined food. So I mean, like wild rice would be a whole grain that you can eat. Good fats, moderate calorie intake, physical activity, limited processed fats, and we're going to talk about fats next week. So this means processed foods. If you're eating processed foods, I don't care what type of fat in it, it's not going to be good for you. Limited processed meats. So although meat, when it's a whole meat, especially if it's from a grass-fed source, that's excellent. Limiting processed meats is very good. And most importantly, limiting refined grains. This is what we talked about during week one. It's what I've been emphasizing the entire lecture is eating whole foods, staying away from refined and processed foods. You can see it's not that much different with diabetes. What I don't have on here is specifically sugar, but that goes under limiting refined grains. And this will not only help to prevent, but it also helps in the treatment and management of diabetes. And that's it.